My name is François Bonivard from Geneva. On our way home from Fribourg to Geneva with my two brothers, our stagecoach got hijacked by some heavy-armed thugs from the Savoyans, which at that time were the masters of Chillon. They tied us up, they beat us up, and they threw us in the dungeon of their castle to rot. Just because we didn't want to pray to the same God as they did. 6 years later, the Bernese took over the Watt, and with the help of some friends from Geneva, they liberated me. My two brothers stayed there, buried. So now my hair is gray, but not only with years. Nor grew it white in a single night, as men's have grown of sudden fears. My limbs are bowed, though not with toil, but rusted with a vile repose. For they have been a dungeon spoil. And mine has been the fate of those to whom the godly earth and air were banned, barred, forbidden fair. I suffered chains, I courted death. But that was for my father's fate. That father perished at the stake for tenets he would not forsake. And for the same his lineal race in darkness found a dwelling place. We were seven who now are one, six in youth and one in age, finished as they had begun, proud of persecution's rage. One in fire and two in field, their belief in blood have sealed, dying as their father died, for the God their foes denied. Three were in a dungeon cast, of whom this wreck is left the last. There is seven pillars of Gothic mold in Chillon's dungeon deep and old. There is seven columns, massy and gray, dim with the dull imprisoned ray. A sunbeam that had lost its way and through the crevice and the cleft of the thick wall has fallen, left creeping over the floor so damp, like a marsh's meteor lamp. And in each pillar there is a ring, and in each ring there is a chain. This iron is a cankering thing, for in these limbs its teeth remain, with marks that will not wear away. Till I have done with this new day, which now is painful to these eyes that have not seen a sun to rise for years. I cannot count them over. I list their long and heavy score when my last brother drooped and died while I was living by his side. They chained us each to a column stone. We were three, each alone. We could not see each other's face, nor could we move more than a pace and those together. Yet, apart, fettered in hands, but joined in heart, there was still some solace in the earth of the pure elements of earth to hearken to each other's speech and Each turned comforter to each with some new hope or legend old or song heroically bold. But even those at length grew cold. Our voices took a dreary tone, the echo from the dungeon stone, grating sound, not full and free as they of yore were wont to be. It might be fancy, but to me, they never sounded like our own. I was the eldest of the three, and to uphold and cheer the rest I ought to do, and did my best, and each did well in his degree. The youngest, whom my father loved, because his mother's brow was given to him with eyes as blue as heaven. For him my soul was sorely moved, and truly might it be distressed to see such boy in such a nest. For he was beautiful as day, when days were beautiful to me as two young eagles being free. A polar day that will not see the sunset till the summer's gone. A sleepless season of long light, and those he was as pure and bright and in his natural spirit full of joy. With tears for naught but others' ills, and then they flowed like mountain rills, unless he could assuage the woe that he abhorred to view below. The other was as pure of mind, but formed to combat with his kind, strong in his frame and of a mood, which gainst the world in war had stood and perished in the foremost rank with joy. But not in chains to pine, his spirit withered with their clank. I saw it silently decline, and so perchance in suit did mine. Yet I forced it on to cheer those relics of a home so dear. He was a hunter in the hills, had followed there the deer and the wolf. For him this dungeon was a gulf, and fettered feet the absolutely worst of ills. Lake Leman lays by Chillon's walls, 1,000 feet in depth below, its massy waters meet and flow. Thus much the fathom line was sent from Chillon's snow-white battlement, which round about the waven trolls. A double dungeon wall and wave have made, and like a living grave. Below the surface of the lake, the deep vault lays wherein we lay, we heard it ripple night and day. Sounding over our heads it knocked, and we could feel the winter spray washed through the bars when winds were high and went on in a happy sky. And then the very rock had rocked. We could all feel a shake and shocked. Because we could have smiled to see the death that would have set us free. I said my nearer brother pined, I said his mighty heart declined, he lewd, put away his food. It was not that it was coarse or rude, for we were used to hunter's fare, and for the like had little care. The milk thrown from the mountain goat was changed to water from the moat, and our bread was such as captive steers have moistened for many 1,000 years. Since man first penned his fellow men like brutes within an iron den. But what were these to us, to him? They wasted not his heart or limb. My brother's soul was of a mold which in a palace had grown cold, had his free breeding been denied the range of the steep mountainside. But why delay the truth? He died. I saw it, but I could not hold his head, nor reach his dying hand, nor dead. He died. Though hard I strove in vain to rend and gnash my bonds in twain. He died, and they unlocked his chain and scooped for him a shallow grave, even within the cold earth of our cave. I begged him as a boon to lay his corpse in dust whereon the day might shine. It was a foolish thought. But then within my brain it wrought that even in death his freeborn breast in such a dungeon could not rest. I might have spared my idle prayers. They coldly laughed and laid him there. The flat and turfless earth above the being we so much did love. The empty chain above it lent such murder's fitting monument. And he, the favored and the flower, most cherished since his natal hour, his mother's image in fair face, the infant love of all his race, his martyred father's dearest thought, my latest care for whom I sought to hoard my life, so his might be less wretched now and one day free. He too, who yet had held entire the spirit natural, or inspired, he too was struck, and day by day was withered on that stuck away. Oh God, it is a fearful thing to see a human soul take wing, in any shape, in any mood. I've seen it rushing forth in blood, and I've seen it on the breaking ocean strive with a swollen convulsive motion, and I have seen the sick and ghastly bed of sin, delirious with its dread. But these were horrors. This was woe. And mixed with such, but sure and slow he faded, and so calm and meek, so softly worn, so sweetly weak. So tearless set, so tender and kind, and grieved for those he left behind. With all the while a cheek whose bloom was as a mockery of this tomb, whose tints as gently sunk away as a departing rainbow's ray. With eyes of most transparent light that almost made this dungeon bright, and not a word of mourning, not a groan over his untimely lot. A little talk of better days, a little hope my own to raise, for I was sunk in silence, lost. In this last loss of all the most. And then the sighs he would suppress of fainting nature's feebleness, more slowly drone, grew less and less. I listened, but I could not hear. I called, for I was wild with fear. I knew it was hopeless. But my dread would not be those that manage it. I called and thought I heard a sound. I burst my chain with one strong bound and rushed to him. But I found him not. I only stared in this black spot. I only lived. I only drew the accursed breath of dungeon doom. The last, the soul, the dearest link between me and the eternal brink, which bound me to my failing race, was broken in this fatal place. One on the earth and one beneath, my brothers both had ceased to breathe. I took that hand which lay so still, alas, my own was full of chill. I had no strength to stroke and strive, but felt that I was still alive. A frantic feeling when you know that what you loved will never be so. I don't know why I could not die. I had no earthly hope but fate, and that forbade a selfish death. What next befell me then and there, I don't know well, I never knew. First came the loss of light and air, and then of darkness too. I had no thought, no feeling, none. Among the stones I stood a stone, and was scarce conscious what I wished the shrubless cracks within the mist. For all was blank and bleak and gray. It was not night, and it was not day. It was not even the dungeon light so hateful to my heavy sight, but vacancy absorbing space. fixedness without a place. There were no stars, no earth, no time, no check, no change, no good, no crime, but silence and a stirless breath, which neither was of life nor death. A sea of stagnant idleness, blind, boundless, mute, and motionless. A light broke in upon my brain. It was the carol of a bird. It ceased. Then it came again. The sweetest song e'er ever heard. And mine was glad until my eyes ran over with the glad surprise, for they that moment could not see that I was the mate of misery. But then by dull degrees came back my senses to their wonted track. I could see the prison walls and floor close slowly around me as it did before, and I could see the glimmer of the sun as it before had done. But in this crack through which it came, this bird was perched, as fond and tame, and tamer than upon a tree, a lovely bird with azure wings, and song that said a thousand things, and seemed to sing them all for me. I never saw its like before, I will never see its likeness more. It seemed like me to want a mate, but was not half as desolate. And it has come to love me when none lived to love me so again. And cheering from my dungeon's brink has brought me back to feel and think. I don't know if it late were free or broke its cage to perch on mine, but knowing well captivity, sweet bird, I never wish for thine. Or if it was in winged guise a visitant from paradise, for heaven forgive the thought the while, which made me both to weep and smile. I sometimes deemed that it might be my brother's soul came down to me. But then at last away it flew and it was mortal. Well, I knew, for he would never doose have flown and left me twice so doubly lone. Lone as the corpse within its shroud, lone as a solitary cloud. A single cloud on a sunny day when all the rest of heaven is clear, a frown upon the atmosphere that hath no business to appear when skies are blue and earth is gay. Some kind of change came in my fate. My keepers grew compassionate. I don't know what has made them so. They were inured to sighs of woe, but so it was. My broken chains with their links unfastened did remain, and it was liberty to stride from myself from side to side, and up and down, and then athwart, and tread it over every part. Around the pillars one by one, returning to where my walk begun, avoiding only as I trot my brother's graves without a sot. For if I thought with heedless tread that I profaned their lowly bed, my breath came gaspingly and thick, and my crushed heart fell blind and sick. I made a footing in a wall. It was not therefrom to escape, for I had buried one and all who loved me in a human shape. And the whole earth would henceforth be a wider prison unto me. But I was curious to ascend to my barred window and to bend once more upon the mountains high, the quiet of a loving eye. I saw them. They were the same. They were not changed like me in frame. I saw their thousand years of snow, their wide long lake below and the blue Rhone in fullest flow, I could hear the torrents leap and gush over channeled rock and broken bush. And I could see the white-walled distant town and whiter sails go skimming down. And then there was this little isle that in my very face did smile, the only one in view, a small green isle. It seemed no more scarce broader than my dungeon floor, and on it there were three tall trees, and over it blew the mountain breeze. By it there were waters flowing, and on it there were young flowers growing of gentle breath and hue. The fish swam by the castle wall, and they seemed joyous, each and all. And the eagle wrote the rising blast, but out he never flew so fast as then to me he seemed to fly. But then new tears came in my eye, and I was troubled and would fain I had not left my recent chain. And when I did descend again, the darkness of this dim abode fell on me again as a heavy load. It was as if a new dug grave closing over one we thought to save. And yet my glance, too much oppressed, had almost need of such a rest. It might be years, or weeks, or days. I didn't count. I took no note. I had no hope my eyes to raise and clear them off their dreary moat. At last men came to set me free, I reckoned not why, I asked not where. It was at last the same to me, fettered or fetterless to be, I learned to love despair. And so when they appeared at last, and all my bonds aside were cast, these heavy walls to me had grown a hermitage and all my own, and half it felt as they were come to tear me from a second home. With spiders I had friendship made, and watched them in their sullen trade, had seen the mice by moonlight play. Why should I feel less than they? We were all inmates of one place, and me, the monarch of each race, had power to kill, yet strange to tell. In quiet, we had learned to dwell. My very chains and I grew friends. So much a long communion tends to make us what we are. Even I regained my freedom with a sigh.